Very good afternoon. Myself Dinesh Kumar, recently completed my PhD from Bharadwaj University, and I joined as a product specialist and QC associated head in the company of YBio. And we have the one product that is called Mini Parasurf, that is helpful for the advanced soil concentration method. Parasites, generally most of them know about the parasites. It helps to, the organism which is lives from the host organisms. What are the energies? The most of the energy material will be absorbed from the host cells. Then the host cell will be die, then focus to the another host cell. This is a general term of parasites. At current time, the major humans will be suffered with that parasite infection. When compared to the male female, the most of children will be suffered with the parasite infections. Due to the malnutrition, unhygienic conditions, improper disposal of waste materials, the parasites will be absorbed from the soils and some of the drinking water and some of the materials, edible materials. Parasitology, majorly three different types: blood parasites, tissue parasites and intestinal parasites. This mini parasurf only focus to the intestinal parasites. Statistical analysis, with the reference of Clinical Diagnostic Journal 2012, the most of the people will be suffered with the parasites like Schistosomiasis, Amoebiasis, and then Endomyba coli, Escherichia coli, and most of the parasites will be affected into the children and some of the what is called rural people. Common diagnostic method. Most of the doctors well known about these diagnostic methods. Generally, based on the doctor, will observe the signs and symptoms. Then we have to collect the from the patient sputum, saliva, fecus, and swab, and other things. And it make the two different divides. One is the microscopic analysis, the second one is the DNA analysis for the further confirmation. Why fecal concentration? So totally in the stool sample analysis, three different types. One is the wet mount method, second one is the flotation, third one is the fecal concentration. So when compared to the, among three methods, stool concentration method showed the best results. In the part of the stool concentration method, three different types are there. One is the parasurf, FAC, and macrocon. So Ridley-Ellen method, many of them know about the Ridley-Ellen method. Whenever we are talking about the concentration method, only focus to the Ridley-Ellen method, because it have the a minimal protocols it will be observed, and we can easily see the many numbers of parasites when compared to the wet mount method. Okay, the mini parasurf comes derived from the Ridley-Ellen method. Instead of using the ethyl ether, we are just adding the formalin and tritanex. So this is the results when compared to the Ellen, Haggard, and Ellen and Ridley. So majorly three different methods we are followed. These are the results. So direct method, concentration old method, concentration new method. New method means it's a mini parasurf derived from Ridley-Ellen method. So we can observe the many numbers of parasites when compared to these two methods: direct method, old method, and new method. Mini parasurf. This is the major products. Actually, it have the filtration. Two different filtration. One is the 425 micrometer and 220 micrometer. It have in the middle of the equipment. So we have adding only 3.3 ml of 10% of formalin and 1% of tritanex, and we have to do the centrifugation 2000 rpm for 2 minutes. So we can observe the many numbers of ovocyst larvae from the fecal sample, and we have to take only a minimal amount of stool sample. This is very enough. Comparison study between the Ellen Ridley and mini parasurf. So these are the results. So sieve method, mini parasurf, evergreen, and meridian macrocan. So four different methods are followed. The mini paras are generally derived from the Ridley Allen, but little bit changes, like instead of ethyl ether we are just adding the 1% of tritanex. The remaining protocol will be followed from the Ridley Allen methods. This is the comparison results. So we can, this is the 400 magnification results. We are just to see the comparison, how it work out. This is the image under the microscope. Why do you use mini paras of? Already I told about that, it have the filter and a single use, and we can observe the 25 different types of parasites. Safest, quickest, easiest to use, and we can preserve for years. The filtration and the performance benefits, optimum sample clarity. Majorly cap samples are easily identified through the mini parasof, and we can use through the pneumatic system. This is the major significant points. This is the evaluation report. World Health Organization, it's reported that stool concentration method is good for parasite analysis. So, and mini parasof, among the four different methods, mini parasof is good. Then Mayo Clinic also evaluated, Plasmon publication already evaluated, Arup Labs they are used, and Journal of Clinical Microbiology is the publisher. Then the Vellu CMC, Dr. Sitara Swarnarav evaluated this thing. Hospitals, so far majorly four hospitals are now currently used. Apollo Hospital in Chennai, Dr. Mamta Soni, Meerut Hospital, Dr. Srinivas, and then PGIM here, Chandigarh, Dr. Kamachi Memorial Hospital, Chennai, this is Dr. Kala. So these people currently used. Last 4 years, the Apollo Hospital, Dr. Mamta Soni used this parasites. Okay, thank you so much. The late
presentation. Yes, please. All yours.
This YBIO is headed by Muthu, and Muthu was actually introduced to me by Dr. C. N. Srinivas, director of Laboratories in New York, saying that young company.
So let's get back to the tune with the topic. Does the rally of Topline still continues? Thankfully, Rama Madam put me in this assignment, and then out of the blue I realize my major focus when I get into hospitals is hospitals, because in last 12 years I had built more than 120 hospitals. Now the eye opener for me, when I was just going through, I realized in last year, that's 2018, it was a happening year for labs. Almost 6 labs has gone for IPO. When you say hospitals, it's only 2, Aster and KIMS. But if you see the volumes, what the diagnostics labs, generally when we say labs are very small, so let me correct the numbers. As per KPMG recent report, India has 198,000 hospitals. But on the other side, we have 2 lakh plus labs, other than the hospitals. So if you say it, it's a doubly up volume. Now, the second number, still India has more than 80% of unorganized market, which is a much bigger volume, which I believe, which has to be capitalized. And that's what I believe all the major players are putting up their eyes to converting that unorganized, unstructured market into a structured. And that's what is the real feedback, or that's the real pipeline for taking up for their top lines. And that's what is the discussion, what we are supposed to take it up. I would love to call up the chairperson as well as the moderator for this session. The very interesting topic, that's building volumes, help labs to achieve the scale. So I would love to call Dr. Mukesh Agrawal, Vice President, Vimta Labs. All yours.
slides. So good for you. So you don't have to count the slides and then see how long I'm going to take to talk. First and foremost, thank you, Value Added, for inviting me. And to Dr. Sudha Murthy, who connected me to Ms. Rama, and I'm here with you guys. Good initiative taken by Value Added, because this is the most neglected topic, not only in curriculum, but also we have been attending a lot of CMAs. We talk about academics and all, but this is which we are forced to practice eventually, because we cannot be behind microscope, behind automation, and we are either forced or we take it voluntary. It's up to us. So Dr. Sudha has taken it voluntary, and she has been a management graduate. My co-speaker, Dr. Anjani, was forced into going on being an entrepreneur, and she's experiencing that good way. Coming to the topic which has been assigned to me is can building volumes help lab to achieve scale? So the audience, what's the answer from you? The answer is yes. And anybody who would like to say no? But anyways, there's a part of the panel discussion. Mr. Govindrajan will take it subsequently. He's going to talk about con. But let's assume like, is that we all agree to this fact. So if you have to really say that building volumes will have lab to achieve scale, but this is true in actually every business. Not only why we are talking about lab is true for each and every fraternity. Now the question is, why so? Why only in the lab? We have been discussing, I heard about the hospitals offering the small packages which has to be rolled out. We've been talking about the incentives being offered. We have been talking about the tests being done at a lower cost, which is being there to, you know, build up scale. But I'll give you some examples. Like we always miss out on the fact that is when I put my hand forward for doing a test at a camp which is being conducted, which you call as RWA camp, by any kind of thing, we don't even think twice to shell out the 300 rupees or 500 bucks. It has become so commoditized. When we don't bother to get ourselves tested, retested, n number of times, under anticipation that we have to shell what, 500 bucks? Nothing. The person is coming to my doorstep, what's harm in getting it tested done? So we miss out on a very important fact is, there is no entry barrier, which is leading and putting us into this particular phenomenon is we can always build up a volume, and then we, by building up volume, because of no entry, we can always look at further scaling it up. Now coming to some examples which we have seen in other, like, have you heard of Subhiksha? So you remember how they started off. You heard of Reliance? When they started with their Reliance Fresh, everybody is talking about that the grocery shop in every nook and corner will come to standstill. They will be losing out business. Did it happen? Means we still, Reliance Fresh exists. We are still finding the grocery, small grocery shop, they are doing more business than what Reliance Freshes are doing in. So it is basically paved a way to scale their businesses as well. There was a concept which was created by someone else who has paid a business for doing that. Now coming to building volumes. So we have been hearing various kind of models in the lab. It could be a standalone reference lab. It could be hub and spoke model. It could be a big hospital who has got chains. It could be even a very specialized and ophthalmic chain who wants to venture out into a laboratory business as well. It could be a non-laboratory medicine personnel who want to venture out into laboratory business. So you have various magnitude. It again boils down to how much deep pocket you have, how much you want to explore, and how much deep you want to dive into this ocean of a funny business called as laboratory medicine. And that's what we are trying to explore the fathom and then do it. I'll try to bring another important aspect which is going to be point of my discussion. Dr. Anjani is going to talk about is, we always move on the fact that there are certain very interesting statistics which has come out. We have heard of Karachi Bakery. Again, very much Hyderabad. If you see, they were doing huge volumes, not as compared to what they are doing now, from that stunted at one point where we have to go to Mozam Jai market, stand in queue, and we were reluctant to go and buy Karachi Bakery over there, biscuits over there. Split happened. and you see the magnitude have got multiple times with the same thing, and it has reached, it has flooded the entire market. I'd like to give example of Royal Enfield. Now, Royal Enfield at time was about to close the shop. But in last 6 months, 1 year, they have totally revamped the entire business. Now coming to the pathology example. We talk about Lal's Path Lab. Now, I still remember my college days, I would say 1993, 94, when I happened to visit Delhi, one of my colleagues, and it was in Rohtak, about 60 kilometers from Delhi. And they were trying to do HB electrophoresis or gene analysis. So the entire NCR, Haryana, Delhi region, where this test can be done is only Dr. Lal Path Lab, no one else. So there was some value add which was created by that person, that particular lab. And subsequently, which was given a business angle to it, which has seen them going IPO and see how much they have traveled from what they were. So there was some value add which they had, which is now shaping up. Giving an example like Indigo Airlines. Now Indigo Airlines, when they came into the market, we all know that there was a stiff competition in the airline industry. But what was their the value add? It was an on-time performance. And that has swept the entire industry. So they were not a me to be what they have to operate upon. There was some differentiator. So coming to the same thing, when it comes to the lab, as I think Tarun had a right question, is we do a pricing which is competitive, then it is volume, then it is value. Now, I would say is 99 out of us will always do a pricing more or less based on the competitive pricing. We never do our own recipe cost. We look at about 10 price list, do a comparison, and try to fit where I'm going level 3 or level 4. Even if you have a good bottom line, you want to achieve a better top line, but you always miss out on the bottom line and always try to target the top line by being at number 3 and level low. So how you have to be a differentiator? So unless and until you become unique, you become what you are, you cannot have a different perspective to reach to that particular scale. So yes, true, the volumes will definitely help you to bring up scale up. It's the matter, but the choice is our own. The choice is ours, how you would like to reach to that particular scale. If you want to, you know, cut short and go aggressive into the market because it's again a no barrier thing, or else you want to have a long innings to be placed and then you want to scale it up. It's individual perception how you want to be. So there will be much more which will be part of panel discussion, but since we all agree to the fact is I'm trying to bridge Dr. Ranjini's talk and mine to see that by agreeing fact, but value add definitely brings in a lot of thing. Thank you very much for the kind attention.
Thanks. I believe a great takeaway what I can understand, and the lesson is always, yes, top line is always important. To continue the same theme what we are looking at, I would like to call Dr. Rajini. Speaking on the value testing over volume testing, typically always there is a fight, is it volume or it is value? So I do remember, again, I'm going back to a share value. So if you see a share of 900 rupees or a share on 200 rupees, automatically people get to know the answer whether we should go for a volume or we should get a value. So Dr. Lal is a known model for value, where they look forward for a value and the margins are still intact. While there are a couple of other players also, I don't want to quote the name, but definitely they diluted their volumes, and within $1,000 you can do 500 plus or 100 plus test, and you never know whether it's a sinking test or it's a real test. So I think I'll call Dr. Rajini on dais. Ranjini, I'm so sorry, Dr. Ranjini Chakravarti from CPath Lab, to understand and give throw some light on value versus volume, focusing on emerging in laboratory business of late. Thank you.
Thank you, Mukesh. Thanks, Mrs. Rama, for inviting me to this event. And I must admit, this is going to be a bit of an impassioned plea over a very academic session, because particularly because this is something which is really close to my heart. And as I speak, I do. So, you know, the points that I'm going to actually talk about over the next 10-15 minutes are my core philosophy, and I base my business, so-called business, on my philosophy as well. This way. How does it? Okay. So, what is value from the lab perspective? I mean, it's not an abstract concept, and as we have been discussing all day, it is objective and it is quantifiable. But before that, we take one step back, and how do we perceive our industry at all? Or healthcare as a whole? Is it a business where our only interest is in cash in the bank, or is this our endpoint? Quality healthcare, which is person-centric, efficient, effective, equitable, and safe. So, the same thing. Personal wealth versus health for all. Of course, the diagnostic industry is also about other values. It's typically about values, all kinds of values, in range, out of range, normal, abnormal. So, and as Mukesh did mention, I still think volume-based labs are very much the prevailing scenario. Even the labs which focus on, which provide quality are also still focused on volume as well. And the way things are, you know, the way the market is with really low margins, volumes are the only way to actually sustain any lab, however much you want to focus on value. But also, I think there is enough volume for everybody, right? With a country with as populous as India, you're always going to get the volumes. The volumes are given, and the diagnostic service industry is, expected to grow at 27-30% over the next 5 years, and with increasing burden of chronic disorders as well as an increasingly health-conscious populace, the volumes are definitely a given. However, what are the problems that volume-driven labs face? And again, as Mukesh has already spoken about, there are no entry-level barriers, and there are essentially too many players to share the pie. Most of this sector is still unorganized and being dominated by mom-and-pop corner labs with scant regard to quality. And let us not take any names, but most of the industry still seems to be running on undercutting, and this is something we face every day. As a smaller setup, we really can't match prices with the bigger organizations, but we are forced actually to match our prices with them just to stay afloat in the market. It's essentially a commodity, isn't it? And mostly routine tests. And anybody can set up a lab with a minimum investment. So this is the current scenario with most volume-based labs versus value-based labs. So why do we need value at all? Basically, from a business perspective, it improves your relations with doctors, it provides for reliability, it helps build your brand value, patients have confidence in your system, and eventually it does increase business. And what are these value-based labs? Most labs, value-based labs that are currently extant are basically specialty labs. Most of them are led by professionals with focus on specific areas, bitten by the entrepreneurial bug, whether voluntarily or involuntarily. We have molecular labs. We have labs such as mine with a focus on histopathology. We do have labs which are focusing on high-end chemistry or on specialized microbiology. The business advantage with these labs would be that, these are niche markets, with easy branding and they can be sold as a premium service. And usually the focus is on quality as they are run by high-end professionals. And they do have some kind of survival advantage because they're less easily replicated. That sort of expertise is thin on the ground. I think Dr. Salil is not here today, is he?
Salil is here, but he's gone out.
Okay, so that's an outstanding example, right? He has one of the best molecular labs in the country, simply driven by his passion for molecular sciences. And why do we need them at all? So with in the era of precision medicine, where physicians frequently request lab tests which are way beyond their understanding, we need to serve as a bridge, as a liaison between the test that is being performed and the need of the patient. It is up to us to actually correctly interpret the result and also to advise the clinician about further reflex testing so that finally there's an actionable event, which is, after all, the end point of any lab test. So basically, the whole idea of being a value-based lab is that we stop being a commodity, and we all labs have a higher valuation, essentially to drive better outcomes for patients, providers, and for the financial stakeholders. In this transition from being volume-based to value-based, labs are basically called upon to provide leadership. Basically, we require to cut costs. We have to be more timely. We need to effectively use our resources, and we need to optimize coordination between physicians and patients, and finally be at the forefront of it all. Though the future of lab medicine is really challenged by both the economic stresses and by new technology that is coming in, we can only really provide impact if we add value to each and every lab test. Of course, there is a cost involved, right, in terms of equipment, infrastructure, personnel, and accreditation. And it's more easily achieved by the bigger labs. So which brings us back to my original question, what is value? And just as Mukesh ended his talk by saying, the volumes are good, but you do need the value as well. I would say the value is good, but you certainly need the volumes just to be able to sustain yourself. And again, in a country like India, I don't think that is difficult. I mean, you can have the volumes, and if you put in the extra effort, you can maintain your values as well. So to end with this, price is what you pay, but value is what you must get. Yes, please.
It would be a little difficult for me sitting in between two medical professionals. What is this finance guy going to be sandwiched? Is it a pro? The pro person is also going to sandwich. The con person is also going to sandwich. So it's a little delicate position, like being the fulcrum in a balance. So I'll try to be, as far as possible, the fulcrum. Just to start, I think most of us sitting here, excluding me and one or two people, they're all medical professionals. Can any one of you practice law, please, sitting here? No. You can't even enter the portals of any court, nor can you practice my profession, the chartered accountant profession. If our top lines are driven by our qualification for which we have studied and got through, why should medical profession be managed by people or run by people who are not doctors? Why should there be? The reason for putting across this point of view is the entry barriers in this industry is suboptimal. Anyone who has a bag of money possibly can think of starting an industry or a lab. So I think the pathology team, you all have your own MCI or the new system vertical, where I think you may have to put it, even to start this line of business, Even a clinician has a 10 by 10 room clinic. He has to have a medicine degree to start with. You know, that is his top line. Whatever he makes is his top line. But he needs that qualification. Why a lab or a hospital could be started tomorrow, you know, already Mr. Ambani has started, but somebody else can also start. So the question in the panel now is, it's very delicate, the top line rally. Should there be top line rally or should it not be there? But no business runs without a top line. It needs to be, if it is a business, it has to have an element of top line, a middle line and a bottom line, or at least top line equal to middle line for some time. But it can't be a continuous top line being lower than the middle line. So the profitability of an institution makes, while both the panelists, in the last 1 and 1.25 hours, enlightened the entire team with their viewpoints, I would place only one question to them, which I will, I have already made a note of it, which addresses about 3-4 areas of should there be top line, should there not be top line, the pros and cons, and what it should be. The one critical function in this entire healthcare gamut is your top line is not driven by inanimate objects. Even a pathological lab, the sample comes from a human being. Or the equivalent of it, when you come across and say, it has to be treated with empathy. You charge what you are charging, but there is a factor called empathy which comes into play. And even a Boeing can work with a Six Sigma, whether it's a lab or a hospital cannot work with Six Sigma. It's a binary function. Is it 0 or 1? There is nothing in between. Either it's a correct analysis or a not correct analysis. So in that space, I'll just take about a minute, then I'll hand it over to the panelist. Nowadays, everyone starts looking at concentrating on your top line growth. The reason being, do I have an unutilized capacity? Because everyone puts up the best of the facilities, so best of the capacities. High volume capacities. And are they using their resources? Volume based resources. While driving the top line, I would also request both the panelists to dwell on. You were talking about quantity, value and quantity. Is it the profit, qualitative profits you are looking, or the quantitative profits you are looking? The quality of top line depends on the quality of profits or the quantity of profits of any institution. In the entire run through the maze of top line, are we ignoring the quality somewhere in between? Because I don't think either the pro or the con speakers will disagree and say there is no need for top line. The question is what and how, to what extent it is. I now request Dr. Mukesh to take over, and I will leave both of you to say either on the con or on the or together, Kichdi banana, kichdi bhi banana.
Thank you. Thank you for question. That's difficult. But before starting the answering the question, I would like to tell him about the sandwich. The sandwich, the content is more important, which is inside. So you have heard of butter sandwich, chicken sandwich, vegetable sandwich. So the content is more. Breads are never important. That only Subway has made it important. And same with Kanta, fulcrum is more important, not the pans. So fulcrum plays the important role. So he has used his all law and finance knowledge to make him more appear that he is important. But he's trying to make the breads more important. Yes. Correct. Mr. Govind Raj said, I do concur. Top line is important. But in the lab scenario, it always depends on how you want to achieve your top line, in what way.
that I have been always pro. I have seen the best of the world. In terms of, I have seen the labs which has a huge setup. Even in histopathology, they have the fully automated tissue processor, cover sleeper, a fast tissue processor, automated immunohistochemistry for a load of 10 samples per day. And everybody who knows that, it talks, and that from Sakura Leica, and means it's fun to be in that particular lab. Because that was a 7-star hospital where the guy has enough money to have the best of capability to showcase. He was not utilized that how much he's going to scale it up, how much he wants to utilize it. He was fancy about the technology. He invested. Now coming to the same with biochemistry, means we have been, you know, tormented, I would say, by all the vendors, that you have got this much volume, why don't you put tracks? We'll give you an instrument which has a throughput of 800 tests per hour, 1,000 tests per hour, and we fall to that prey. Think that if I have got a bigger footprint, my lab will be perceived as big. We don't even realize, and our calculations around those 3 or 4 tests, and we always minimize, we don't even look at that the other menu which is being underutilized. It is a simple Pareto principle which goes in place. Means our 20% of the tests bring 80% of the volume. That's all everybody knows. Same thing happened with the automated analyzer. But by doing that, we always spit out that the productivity which we are looking at, we burn out energies, which is electricity, power, water, it all goes down the drain. The same test can be done with a smaller throughput machine, which can be better utilized, giving the same top line. But we are so fancied with bigger elephants, we fall prey to that. Again, I'm trying to say that the bottom line here is quality is intact, ethics are intact, and I'm talking about the lab medicine practices are intact. So that's the bottom line. So I'm not talking about cutting the volumes, making the strips half, doing the test in half volumes, we bring in the better top line. I'm not trying to talk about that. I'm talking that if the basics are strong, the top line can be achieved, provided you have the right mix, right menu, and the right instrument which fits your requirement. If you do that, it's achievable. Let Dr. Anjani speak more on that. Then we
can add. I essentially concur with what Dr. Mukesh said. The top line is important, but not at any cost, right? So you should not be prepared to cut corners, to do anything unethical to achieve that top line. So you do whatever is required to provide a good report, and then, you know, hope that the top line will look okay.
Taking it forward, in my personal view, medical profession in totality is at a crossroad. There is an element of, you know, lawyer trust on one side, and medical cases being taken on the doctors on the other side. You know, these are two very which was never thought of about 15 years ago. Should top line, you know, when you talk of a rally as a top line, you know, come what may, I have to have the top line. I make my budget, you know, every quarter, every month I do my, you know, MIS analysis, and, you know, the board meets, the senior management meets, the, you know, closed door meetings, they talk, you know, how to look at the top line being grown. This is a scenario which I think most of you do know, that there are instances. In light of that, should the doctors, you know, I wouldn't say put a brake on it, should treat a path which is a little more, you know, not to err on the wrong side. Top line. I'm restricting this only to the top line.
Even if whatever the top line is achieved, I'm sure like none of the doctor would even willingly or unwillingly, knowingly or unknowingly, will fall into trap that they will harm a patient. That's never ever at the back of the mind. They will never compromise on ethics and value add to make the part of the top line. Never ever. I can vouch for that. Okay. So I think that's the Hippocratic oath which everybody have taken, and
I'm sure that the best of thing is will not happen. But again, you know, why to go further? We have been hearing on the very recent time the book of Harrison, which is now in the news. Now it has been told means to include the name of the big pharma companies, the medicine name, means the author has been paid money. So if that's the case, we are looking at, I mean, there is no end to it. So everybody would like to have their name getting promoted, famous everywhere. So when we are looking at the books which we have been reading through eternal from our medicine, and that's what is coming to fore light, that he has taken money. It's all again a rumor. We have been talking about what is in the news from the pharma majors. So where are we? So, but again, knowingly or unknowingly, in lab business, to have the top line achieve, nobody will do that. Again, the learning, the practice, which we are being forced to. When the doctors are doctors, because okay, we have a very good set of doctors who have been abiding to their textbooks and have been doing very good. But the pharma or the reps are the most predominant teachers to all the medicine and surgeons. So they practice what has been told to them with that handouts. But unless and to go back to the basics, you will never get to your things right.
Your take, ma'am.
Like Dr. Mukesh just mentioned, most of the American healthcare industry is commerce-driven, right? And as long as we model ourselves on them, right, we are going to hit these roadblocks, right? We do all take the Hippocratic Oath, and it is to be hoped that everybody adheres to it, but there are enough defaulters, right? There are enough rotten apples in the basket, and there is a lot of fraud, right? You know, I know this panel discussion is all about the top line, but I have been exposed to a very different healthcare system, right? I was in UK for a very long time. The NHS, I know, has its critics, but to me, it was a little beacon of light and hope, right? You know, if we call ourselves civilized, the least we should be able to do is to provide quality healthcare to all our citizens, right? And definitely the US healthcare model utterly fails in that. And there, the rally, of course, is always for the top line. And we are aping them when we think healthcare is only about the top line. Whereas, you know, there are other models. As a healthcare system, the US is one of the worst. They are ranked the 37th or the 40th in terms of healthcare outcomes, right? Whereas the socialistic countries always top healthcare outcomes. It's France, which always has the best outcomes for any disorder. And similarly in UK, totally untouched by commerce, right? Everybody does what is required for the patient. You know, you're not even required to, you only order generic drugs, right? You usually put down a pharmacological name and the pharmacist doles out the drugs, right? The clinicians don't even have the authority to write out an antibiotic. It's the clinical microbiologist who will test the sample in his lab and then he suggests the antibiotic, right? So there is, it's essentially untainted by anything commercial. So, that is another a perspective to healthcare, and I don't see why we shouldn't look towards that side, right? Why do we always have to ape the American healthcare and be obsessed with top lines? And an example, right? The US CAP is the biggest pathology meeting, and it's like literally for me at least, it's like going to Mecca every year. And there are usually close to 10,000 delegates, and you have the who's who of pathology. So there is like the most prestigious oration. The mad about mod about oration or something, oratory award, which is usually done by the senior most pathologist. And I remember year after year, it will be about remuneration, right? It's about all the money they have made. And you can see that even, you know, pathologists are a different breed, and we are confined to our microscopes. And most of them, you know, are not really that commercial. But even there, you know, all you could see was them talking about money and the money per sample. So, I can't understand the obsession with top line. Of course, you know, being in the business, I do I'm forced to actually acknowledge the importance of Topline, because yeah, there is a mission, there is a vision, but without vitamin M, you're nowhere. But that should not be the only thing that dictates your practice.
Yeah. While driving the Topline, or the new things which are coming into the market is something called shop in shop concept. Even diagnostic labs are getting into hospitals and tying up with others. Would you think that in the long run this would stay to help the Topline grow, or it's a short term phenomena, because most of the labs today are pitching in to take over the hospital labs, more specifically pathology related and imaging related angle. Do you think that it has a long term positive impact, or it's a short term Topline rally, or over a period of time it will get stabilized and may take a downturn?
Your Topline will
definitely going to help if you are doing S&S business.
No, man, I feel like it's a brownfield, so there is an existing business. It's always easy for them to, they have an existing one. It's easy for them to have that volume coming to them, and it spirals up. Again, the lab which has started in a hospital, which is, they have started because it was a necessity. Hence the lab has started, but eventually they realize, I have done the due diligence of the big labs and big hospital labs. And to my surprise, it was when they were trying to offload their lab business to another lab who wants to take it, when the projection of material consumption was 15%, 18%. But if we go deep down into them, we got to know that the reagent inventory, which is not meeting the instrument, but the bank has issued them some kind of a slips that this is their inventory that's in their inventory. They have been cutting corners on the type of the tubes being used. They have been reusing their tips, gloves, containers again and again. So the situation is pathetic. When they realize and then they get to know that it is a high time where they should offload, then this business starts off that, okay, means you do and take it over. Obviously, to have a good top line, this is a good model, because there is always a captive business which can be embraced immediately. The hospital get advantage out of it is in terms of they get obviously advantage, and the lab, because of the back-end processing volumes, they get volumes, and they have more dictating terms with the vendors. So it goes that way. And it's going to stay back, means unless and until there is a huge hospital who wants to run his own lab, and they really want to make a good value out of it.
Okay.
I guess it's a question of sticking to your core competencies, right? Most smaller setups which will require to outsource their lab would be started by physicians with their core areas of comfort. So which is why they would probably like to associate with lab professionals to help them set up the lab if it's a new hospital. Saying which, again, everything is dictated by money, and they are pretty unrealistic, right? The few, at least the experiences we have had, it's their expectations from the lab are pretty unrealistic. You are left with holding all the expense, and all they want is a big share of the revenue. So half the time, it seems to me to be unviable.
Some people have even quoted below the material cost price.
Yeah, that happens all the time, yeah.
One last, with that, I think I'll request the delegates if they have a question. Is the new thing which has come in the Modi Care, will it impact labs in driving the top line? If so, does it have any impact, does it have a fallback mechanism through the insurance route? Because Modi Care in the present form has to evolve via the insurance mode if it is going to be a sustainable healthcare delivery model in the country. which is very close to bordering health for all as a concept. Would it be, you know, I looked at it, the diagnostics is the first step in this line, because otherwise 5 lakhs, everyone wants to go to the hospital and get a surgery done. If they put a cap and say that within last 6 months you should have had a health checkup done, naturally if there are any issues, it would have come out in the normal course. So maybe a health check related support service through the insurance, will it help you on the top line drive? Because growth will come, it is a pure volume game.
It certainly will, and like I said, we are the second most populous nation in the world, and soon will be. So, you know, anything that tries to achieve universal health coverage is going to push up volumes. And I believe we are sitting quite pretty in terms of pricing. We are already down to rock bottom, unlike the fat cat hospitals, which mark up everything impossibly. So, you know, I think it will be good for labs if it does become universal coverage.
I would like to wait for election 2019, and Modi care should not take the Obamacare way.
But again,
the insurance sector is a good one. But again, the CGHS and the insurance pricing, which is being done, where you need a 60-year-old physician who can just sign off the report, and the report is accepted from any of the community, or if it's go the Mohalla clinic way, then that's going to be a difficult call. But the good initiative, only thing is you have to see a light at the other tunnel. So if it works well, it can be worked on.
Yeah, the probability
made in India concept is working well, and it should bring down price.
Yeah, the hospital concept is working reasonably well.
Yes.
Well, I'll request the audience if they have any questions, please.
Wonderful.
There is something which is coming up is EDL, Essential Diagnostics List, which is actually going to throw up opportunities, is what the schemes are saying. I guess it is kind of, it will be linked to Ayushman Bharat and the free diagnostic schemes which are going to be launched by the state governments. So they have listed out about 137 investigations. The industry version is, once, because the final draft is ready, it is going to be announced very soon, finally. And they say that it's going to throw up plenty of opportunities for the diagnostics. But my guess is, whatever is the rock bottom that it has hit already, the pricing, it is going to be much lower than that.
So we have to fight them, right? Mm. Or they have to help us with reducing costs.
Mm. See, there has to be a representation. Now, this is something which is driven by the IVD community. That's something which I could pick up. Now, the pathologists have to be on the... absolutely, because... as EDL is something which cannot be determined by the IVD community alone, because this is what I told the ICMR chief when I met her at recently. Ma'am, you can't do this. So engage the pathologist. No, we've done two rounds already. No, because it's 90 days is the cutoff time for the draft which they've announced. January 31st is the cutoff time. Please go back and represent. They will link it. They will link it. They say EDL is going to be for the Ayushman Bharat scheme, and the Delhi government is doing free diagnostics, and each government is going to PPP initiatives. They are going to kickstart this. It may certainly throw up opportunities, but already you're all swimming in the red oceans and nobody is actually trying for a blue ocean at all. So it's going to be... I just wanted to know whether this EDL is actually going to add any an additional improvement to your top line or your bottom line. I really don't know, but maybe the industry should be prepared for it.
Maybe we should fight for our corner. Yes. Make sure at least our places are covered.
Thankfully, we are good in copying the structure. Unfortunately, we have not copied one formula from Obamacare. In if I have a premium of 5 lakh, I can go for diagnostics for only 20% of it. Now, in India, it's not like that. So I see an opportunity. I can admit a patient and do a 5 lakh rupees of a diagnostics. Nobody will ask a single question. There's no capping on diagnostics. So for me, I think I see a big volume which can easily roll down on Ayushman Bharat. That's the play as of now. I can tell you, I don't know, might be some more filters will come in in near future, but yes, that's the way forward. Wonderful. A very any further more questions? Wow.
See, actually, what has been happening around by the governments, which is like in Ayushman Bharat, he's been talking about, triple P projects has been taken over by the government. And the majority of this triple P projects has been taken over by the bigger labs. So what is the survival rate of those labs, those mid-sized labs or the regional labs? They don't get this opportunity. So majority of time, which we have observed out in triple P projects, is that the bigger lab chains takes up the whole projects out. So survival rate of mid-sized labs is very poor. I don't know how it will going to help out.
There is a trending process that do happens, but again, the mid-size and small-size lab, they have their own chunk, because corporate lab or the big chain labs will take this bigger chunk of the volume. The most worrisome is, I'm worried about the touts in between who will crop up, who will take this in a different strand altogether. So we'll still have those intermediary labs will have a place where some business will come up from their EDL, because WH has already launched it quite early. We are trying to frame some package out of it. But let's see if the ICMR initiative, the WH has asked the ICMR to roll it out. So let's see what is there to offer.
Thank you, Doc.
So to sum up the session, I believe my version of a story is, at the end of the day, I don't know whether the hospital makes money, the lab makes money. I'm sure it's only the medical equipment companies who makes money out of it. Thankfully, there is no...
Nobody sitting here. There. Do you have any doubt on that?
That's right. So there's a reason the promoters buy equipment, and it's a white elephant or a overbuying of a medical equipment without knowing the capabilities or the capacity what they're running at. And I'm sure there's a reason they'll upgrade you from Maruti to Honda to BMW, and then they'll sell a hybrid car. So you have to run it for 3 years, then only you'll be able to get your operating expenses. So that's how it is, I believe. I'll just sum it up the whole session. I would love to call Dr. Bhatia to facilitate the panel. Yeah, that's what I think. Let's call off with a last pick for the day. I'll call everybody to the stage. So let's have a click together. I'll call all the team members who has put huge effort, BCC Healthcare, Ilyas, Dr. Rama, to put all of us into one rope. She was, every time I was got jealous the way the effort she has to done. The kind of mail she used to shoot on WhatsApp.
Enjoy thoroughly the exceptional knowledge flow.